لو سمحنا ممكن ان شاء الله نبدا. انا خلاص I start the streaming on YouTube now, so it is YouTube live and on
اتفضل
Zoom
يا
ان شاء الله.
دكتور.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We will start today with our presentation on Zoom from online OFSA. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Osama Osman. He's one of my best friends and he is a professor of glaucoma and in King Saud University. He's a professor in the Department of Ophthalmology, King Saud University in Riyadh. Dr. Osam is one of the eminent names in glaucoma surgery in Riyadh. I know him from many years now personally, and he is scientifically one of the best and one of the eminent names, as I said. So we will enjoy today his lecture. So let's welcome Dr. Osam Osman, and he can start his lecture today. تفضل دكتور عصام.
شكرا دكتور اسلام. Thank you very much. Welcome for all our colleagues. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. دكتور اسلام رمضان presented a few days back a nice lecture about glaucoma, general lecture about glaucoma, and also Dr. Tag present an excellent lecture about congenital glaucoma. Today my topic will be a subspecialty lecture in very hot topic, as you know, neovascular glaucoma. Unfortunately, it is common disease. Instead of awareness about diabetic retinopathy now is very good in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and in Egypt, but still we are facing a lot of cases with vascular glaucoma every day in our practice. What we'll discuss in this lecture, the definition of neovascular glaucoma, تعريف المرض, the causes, أسباب المرض, الباثولوجي حق النيوفاسكر جلوكوما, وبعدين هنتكلم على الوصف الإكلينيكي اللي هي الكلينيكال بيكشر اوف ذيس ديزيز. Then we'll discuss the management, العلاج, طرق العلاج المختلفة للنيوفاسكر جلوكوما. Then in the end I will present a study done by my colleague in our institute about neovascular glaucoma cases. في الآخر هنعرض بحث علمي في جامعة الملك سعود بزملائنا في قسم الجلوكوما والشبكية عن النيوفاسكولار جلوكوما. النيوفاسكولار جلوكوما is one of most challenging form of secondary glaucoma. هنقف على كلمة secondary. في فرق when I discuss primary glaucoma and secondary glaucoma. إيش الفرق؟ primary glaucoma, as you know already, and in spite of we are trying to delay the progression, not to stop the progression, we cannot stop the progression primary glaucoma, but our aim is to delay the progression, and I'm talking here about the primary open angle glaucoma. When I talk about secondary glaucoma, the story is different. Secondary glaucoma, the disc is not a glaucomatous from the start. This is normal disc exposed to a cause of raising the intraocular pressure like uveitic glaucoma, neovascular glaucoma, traumatic glaucoma. This disc is different from the disc who has already tendency to have glaucoma. So when you deal with secondary glaucoma, it's different completely like you deal with primary glaucoma. And that's why we'll talk about management here. We should not be in a hurry to get rid of glaucoma, get rid of the disease by glaucoma surgery early. We should try to control the intraocular pressure. We should try to treat the cause. And even when the pressure is high, because this disc with high pressure, for certain time, it will not be damaged. This we'll discuss in detail later. So this is the difference between primary glaucoma and the secondary glaucoma. It occurs when fibrovascular tissue proliferates to the chamber of anterior angle and the iris and obstructs the trabecular meshwork, produce peripheral anterior synechia and the progressive angle closure. The elevated intraocular pressure usually difficult to control. So it is rare to get one case of neovascular glaucoma with normal intraocular pressure, except in some situation we'll mention in end of lecture. And this definitely will lead to loss of vision. This is the new vessel you can see in the surface of the iris. Normally, when you examine any patient on a slit lamp, you will not find any new vessel in the surface of the iris. You can see it in the angle. It is called NVA in the pupil margin and in the retina elsewhere or around the optic disc. Neovascular glaucoma in 1871 named by Stecher as a hemorrhagic glaucoma. So this is the first name given for neovascular glaucoma by Stecher in 1871. This is from the history. Then it is named the neovascular glaucoma by West في 1963. This is the name given to the disease. So what is the causes of the disease? What is the leading causes? أسباب المرض. This is what we'll discuss now. طبعا the causes, 97% of the causes is due to retinal scheme, which is from diabetic retinopathy, central retinal vein occlusion, and the carotid artery disease. This is if we talk about Middle East, but if we talk about Europe, the commonest cause in Europe is central retinal vein occlusion, then diabetic retinopathy. So what other causes can cause also neovascularization and neovascular glaucoma? It is not only diabetic retinopathy and central retinal vein occlusion, but there is other causes can cause new vessels and the formation of this disease, which is central retinal artery occlusion, branch retinal vein occlusion, sickle cell anemia, AIDS disease, Coats disease, retinopathy of prematurity, chronic uveitis, long-standing uveitis. You can see new vessel in the surface of the iris, intraocular tumor and radiation from treatment for cancer, radiation retinopathy. Actually, Michelson in 1948, he started about talking about X factor, angiogenic factor, responsible for this formation of new vessels. We can see there is angiogenic factor, they call it X factor at that time, which may be due to inflammation, tumor, retinal circulatory disorder, retinal detachment, chronic retinal detachment. And this factor actually escaped to the anterior chamber and accumulate in anterior chamber and induce new vessel in the surface of the iris as well as the angle. Actually, by Singer et al. In 1996, they call it vascular endothelial growth factor, and it is one of nine of non-polypeptide growth factor specific for endothelial cell and cause endothelial cell migration and the mitosis, and it increased endothelial cell permeability. This vascular endothelial growth factor, where is the sources in the eye? Actually, in Journal of Glaucoma published that it may be expressed and produced by corneal endothelium, iris pigment epithelium, retinal pigment epithelium, ganglion cells, astrocyte, mainly molar cells, uveal melanocyte, and the choroidal fibroblast. So this is the sources of the vascular endothelial factor from the retina. This is another study in 210 vitrectomized sample. And they took vitreous sample من 210 patient. These patients are actually diabetic. They found that vascular endothelial growth factor 36 more times than in proliferative diabetic retinopathy than non-proliferative. So it exists in proliferative diabetic retinopathy 36 times more than non-BDR. And also they found that the vascular endothelial growth factor is more in the aqueous humor. And when a patient has pan-retinal photocoagulation, they found that this patient of retinal photocoagulation, they have decreased the vascular endothelial growth factor in 75%. So vascular endothelial growth factor plays a major part in mediating active intraocular neovascularization in patients with ischemic retina disease. And there is another study by many authors here in Ophthalmology, Journal of Glaucoma, Diabetic Care, that there is marked elevated of vascular endothelial growth factor in the aqueous in patients with neovascular glaucoma. And now, luckily, we have anti-angiogenic therapy. In the past, we don't have these agents. As you know, we have Lucentis, Avantis, and Eylea, and it is available in market, and it helps also to treat this type of disease. So what about band-retinal photoaccumulation? I would like to mention that the main treatment of neovascular glaucoma is retinal laser. We'll talk about Avastin, Lucentis, and others. This is adjunctive, but it is not the main treatment. So you should put in your mind that the main treatment is laser treatment. We want to change the ischemic retina to anoxic retina. When you change ischemic retina to anoxic retina, there will not be release of this vascular endothelial factor, and this can explain also those patients of high myopia which have anoxic retina, it is rare to develop diabetic retinopathy. What PRB do actually do two things very nice, upregulate the tissue transforming growth factor B, and upregulate also derived pigment epithelium factor, two factors. So upregulation of this transforming growth factor B, which is known vascular endothelial cell inhibitors. So when it upregulates this, it will stop angiogenesis. The second thing, as actually it is upregulated also the retinal pigment epithelium derived factor. And it is well known that it is potent inhibitor for ocular angiogenesis. So this is the function how PRB treat, change this, stop this new vascularization and stop releasing of this vascular endothelial growth factor. So the major benefit of PRB is destruction of this vascular endothelial growth factor by upregulation of certain angiogenic inhibitors. This is very important to know. So now we'll come to clinical presentation, اللي هو الوصف الكلينيكي المريض، كيف المريض بيجي للمستشفى أو للطوارئ أو للطبيب في العيادة. The clinical presentation, this is one of acute glaucoma. So one of differential diagnosis of acute angular glaucoma is neovascular glaucoma. So usually the patient presented to emergency by severe pain and marked reduced in visual acuity. Injected eye, as you can see in this picture, highly elevated intraocular pressure, anterior action, anterior chamber reaction, mid-dilated non-reactive pupil, rubiosus irides, and also neovascularization in angle of anterior chamber. This is a clinical picture. And when you do gonioscopy, majority of patients, they have closed angle. Sometimes the patient presented early. As you know, there is a stage of new vessel in the angle without raising the pressure, then stage of new vascular membrane in angle where the angle is open, but the pressure is high. And the stage where this fibrosis occur and cynical angle closure and acute shot of intraocular pressure. Majority of patients are presented actually in the third stage in which the angle is closed. So look, very strange that Duke Elder in 1969 mentioned that inoculation is the only practical treatment for neovascular glaucoma. I remember in the past when we are just graduated, when we face a case of neovascular glaucoma, we have a trouble how to treat these cases. And the grants in 1974 mentioned no means are known to prevent neovascular glaucoma. And Hoskin in 1974 mentioned the treatment of neovascular glaucoma is disheartening. But lovely outcome has improved dramatically. And new medication and surgical approach are available. Better understanding and control of angiogenesis now. Here, important, this word mentioned by Flanagan in 1983, which is the key point of treatment of neovascular glaucoma. What he mentioned, Flanagan, actually, he mentioned that if these neovascular elements can be removed and the further neovascularization are prevented, so we are left with a case of uncomplicated chronic angle closure glaucoma, which can be managed easy with any classical drainage surgery. Very nice statement, actually. Then when you stop this vascular endothelial growth factor, when you stop this neovascularization, and I become quiet, you are dealing with a case of chronic ankylosing glaucoma that any filtration surgery can solve the problem. معروف طبعا الوقاية خير من العلاج, the prevention. And this is what we are talking about, awareness about the diabetic retinopathy. So recognition of high-risk patient, correction of underlying pathology, close observation to any patient with NVI or NVA, efficient and sufficient treatment of laser treatment. This is very important statement because we are seeing a lot of patients with insufficient photocoagulation. I know that some patients cannot withstand the laser treatment. Some are escaping from the first session from the physician. But try to convince the patient that pan-retinal photocoagulation, full pan-retinal photocoagulation, is very important to suppress the vascular endothelial growth factor and help in treatment of this type of disease. Determinants, very important when you face, you get a case of neovascular glaucoma emergency. And I usually ask my resident when we get a case called by case from emergency by neovascular glaucoma, you check the visual acuity, please. Because many patients, unfortunately, they present with no light perception. So if no light perception, there is route for treatment to differ from a patient with good visual potential. Number two, we should look for the clarity of the medium. This is the protocol of management of neovascular glaucoma. In case of no light perception, non-seeing eye, يعني إذا المريض جاي ما عنده نظر, no vision at all, ففي الحالة دي بندي medical treatment. We'll mention what this treatment. And you can see cyclodestructive procedure. And the aim of cyclodestructive procedure just to reduce the pressure and decrease the pain for the patient. طب if the patient is seeing eye, لو المريض عنده نظر, he has vision, بينقسم لثلاث أقسام. أول حاجة, there is clear media or not. There is poor media for you to see the retina. Or there is no view at all in case of vitreous hemorrhage. If you have clear media, so you go directly and do the main treatment, as I mentioned, not the main treatment is not anti-VGF, is to do pan-retinal photoagulation. And if you add anti-VGF, this is good, and we'll mention why. Then you can go after rebiosis disappear. Never go and operate the patient while there is new vessel. I know sometimes you are obligated to operate in a case came late with advanced damaged disc, and you don't want to wait until the patient loses the vision completely. You interfere while fading of the new vessel in the iris, no problem, but better don't interfere by trabeculectomy or tube surgery except after the new vessel disappear. Usually by pan-retinal photocoagulation, according to the study we've done, it disappears within 1 to 2 weeks. And I mentioned before, don't be in a hurry to operate because this is secondary glaucoma. The optic disc can withstand high pressure for little days. But nowadays, because you have anti-VGF, you can inject Avastin or Lucentis and you can do the operation early. The second thing, when you have good vision and poor media, like cataract or corneal scar, you can remove the lens, like example, you can do cataract extraction. Then you can also do the laser treatment and you can go for trap or tube. If you have vitreous hemorrhage, you have no choice except you do vitrectomy, endolaser, then after that, you can, if the patient need, some people, they apply also laser treatment to ciliary body at that time, or you can go later on, evaluate the patient and you can go for tube or trabeculectomy. This is the framework of treatment of neovascular glaucoma. What about the medical treatment? This is very important to control inflammation. If you depend only to give anti-glaucoma medication, this is not right. Because there is inflamed eye, there is pain, so you should give cycloplegic and steroid. The best is to give atropine and prednisolone acetate increase the frequency also of steroid. Then you give the control intraocular pressure in spite of the patient will never control, but at least it will be less than the baseline IOP presented by the patient. It will not control, but at least it will be less than 45 or 50. You give aqueous suppression. We like to give systemic medication like acetazolamide, clavulanate, 250 TID or QID. Topical steroid, as we mentioned before, and you can give beta blocker and brimonidine. You can give it in combination to decrease the drops. Instead of give 3 or 4 drops, you can give 1 drop like Combigan instead of giving timolol and alfagan, and accompanied by diamox with steroid and atropine. Better to avoid meiotics because it's an inflamed eye, and also avoid prostaglandin. The anti-VGF actually will come here for this. Does we give anti-VGF? This is an important question to all cases of neovascular glaucoma. Suppose you have clear media, everything is fine. I am doing full PRP. Does it is necessary to give anti-VGF? Actually, I like to add anti-VGF to the patient because it makes rapid resolution of NVI. And this is very important statement. It helped in success of glaucoma surgery. Some patients are presented with new vessels angle, but still behind this new vessel, there is still parts of the angle function. So when you make resolution of this vessel, you may enhance the function of some parts of the angle, which help in success of glaucoma surgery later. PRP is the treatment, as I mentioned before, reduce and can eliminate anterior segment neovascularization. When we come to conventional treatment, what is the main treatment after getting the people take care of the patient? And this is very important point because we are sometimes facing a problem between losing the patient between retina and the glaucoma consultant, especially an area in which they respect the subspecialty. I know some people, they work retina and glaucoma at the same time. So we usually advise the patient to be admitted to the hospital to be under care of retina and glaucoma because sometimes the patient lost, he take the PRP, then he disappear and do not come back for glaucoma surgery. Or at least you explain to the patient that most likely you will need glaucoma surgery. So better to follow up until we finish the laser treatment and prepare you for glaucoma surgery. The type of glaucoma surgery go for filtration surgery, tube surgery, cycle-destructive procedures, and other procedures like ultrasound cycloplasty now, UCB. The CBC have high rate actually of serious complication and visual loss. You can see that Shield in 1994 mentioned that visual loss up to 46%. And Ghosh in experimental ophthalmology mentioned that cyclophotocoagulation with anti-VGF has visual loss up to 25%. Cabrulli also in 1985 mentioned that visual loss up to 70%. And Krobin in 1978 mentioned that there is visual loss up to 34. There is no safe procedure actually in mass medicine. CBC can help, but definitely there is some incidence of complications. What about tube surgery? It is have variable success rate, probably more suitable for previously operated eye. And also there is high rate of visual loss and the sizes were by mentioned by Mermod in 1993. I have a good chance to meet with Ahmed Mateen, the one who created Ahmed Valve. And I asked him that tube surgery is excellent, is good, Ahmed Valve. It solves the problem of hypotony, but not the problem of fibrosis. We usually have encapsulation, believe in majority of patients. And he promised to create an exit valve instead of single exit hole, multiple exit hole. This may help to decrease the fibrosis in tube surgery. I like to present special cases before we go for our last end of my meeting today by nice study in our institute. This is special cases to see how sometimes neovascular glaucoma present. This is one patient, 65 years male. He presented with normal intraocular pressure. And when I examine him, he has rubiosus irides. And he has retina laser actually. Then when I go to do gonioscopy, gonioscopy as mentioned by Prof. Tariq Sahrawi in lecture 2 days back, is mandatory for glaucoma subspecialty. You should do gonioscopy as routine in your clinic for all patients, even for patients diagnosed before, because the angle usually changes by time. So when I do gonioscopy for him, I found that he has sinical angle closure. So you expect when you have angle closure and intraocular pressure is normal, this is not expected actually. Then I was thinking that the patient have insufficiency of blood supply to ciliary body. I send him to medical people. He found that he has carotid artery disease. They did for him end arterectomy, and he presented to me after that by a very high intraocular pressure after they correct the carotid, and we did for him trabeculectomy surgery. This is another patient, a lady, 52 years old. She presented with severe pain to emergency with intraocular pressure 45. She is Oncosopt and Alphagan, and she has report that she is treated as open angle glaucoma. This is our picture, but this is actually taken after the pain subside and the injection disappear. This is her retina. When we examine the retina, she has insufficient pan-retinal photocoagulation. She has some laser in the periphery of the retina. You can see here, I don't know, the picture is not clear. She has some lasers in the retina. And when I examine the angle, she has sinical angle control. So when retina people saw the patient, they diagnosed that all the retinal vein occlusion, insufficient treatment. Then more laser are applied to the retina, and patient was treated with later on trabeculectomy with mitomycin, and later on she developed cataract. We did phaco emulsification for her. So the treatment of neovascular glaucoma is different from open angle glaucoma. Patient was Oncosopt and Alphagan, and this is not sufficient. Basically, she didn't take full laser treatment. We added Bradford and Atropine, full anti-glaucoma medications, and this is ideal treatment for neovascular glaucoma. This is an interesting study done at King Saud University, King Abdulaziz University Hospital, by my colleague, Prof. Saleh Al-Abidan, Prof. Ahmed Abu Al-Asrar, and Prof. Saleh Al-Amru, and me. This is talking about full pan retinal photocoagulation improves the outcome of trabeculectomy with mitomycin in neovascular glaucoma. The patient demographic, we have 30 eyes of 27 patients, 20 males and 7 females. The mean age about 53. The diabetic retinopathy was majority of cases. There are 23 cases. And the 7 eyes with central retinal vein occlusion. 27 patients was phakic and 3 patients was pseudophakic. The initial IOP mean was 41. The gonioscopy majority of patients are closed angle, 18 eyes. Open angle in 4 eyes and partially open in 8 eyes. The visual acuity between hand motion and 20/40, there is 20 cases phakic, as we mentioned, and 3 pseudophakic. The number of laser given to the patient, the mean number of shots of pan-retinal photocoagulation was 1,612, range up to 3,790. The rubiosus at time of surgery in 3 cases, as I mentioned to you, we cannot wait for some cases. And actually at that time, there was no Avastin available. Number of medication was 3, range between 2 and 4. The surgical technique was a standard trabeculectomy for all cases. And the mitomycin is used for 2 to 2.5 minutes, 0.2 milligram per ml. And very important thing is I should mention here, in any case you deal with high pressure, you should have precaution of gradual decompression of the eye. Never do the surgery except you do paracentesis and decompress the globe gradually. Don't open the trabeculectomy before you do this step. Otherwise, you may have complications, suprachoroidal hemorrhage, decompression, retinopathy, and other problems. This is a short video about trabeculectomy. The video also contains phaco. We may pass the stage of phaco just to see steps about trabeculectomy. In glaucoma surgery, you can do corneal traction suture, which is sometimes easy and non-painful. You can do suprarectal suture, do whatever you like, but you should have good exposure for area you operate. Usually in glaucoma surgery, we like to go to superior nasal because if the surgery is failed, you can go superior temporal. So better to start in all your surgery superior nasal area quadrant. Conjunctival periotomy, cleaning of the tenon, then releasing incision on both sides. We cauterize the conjunctiva. Better to don't do too much cautery because cauterization making more fibrosis. Then 4x4 quadrangular flap. You can do triangular flap. It will not make difference in success rate. This is by super sharp. Then by another blade, we call it money blade. You can dissect 1/3 or half of the scleral thickness. Also doesn't matter in success of the trabeculectomy. Here there is bleeding, forget the bleeding, let the assistant wash for you or clean for you. Try not to cauterize too much because cauterization will spoil your surgery, will induce fibrosis, will fail your surgery. Try somebody clean you for you or wash, then apply with mitomycin. And usually this bleeding will stop for a few seconds. Mitomycin C will apply it by this week. You cover nicely. Broad area of covering of mitomycin is very important because sometimes proliferation of fibroblasts at the edge of mitomycin and making encapsulation bleb and the failure of your surgery. So apply mitomycin to wide area as you can around the trabeculectomy flap. This is phaco. If we have time, we can show. If we don't have time, we can bypass the phaco now. I think better we go. Here in end of phaco, we put the intraocular lens. Then don't remove the hilum except you do the trabeculectomy. Take care of this point. We don't remove the hilum, yes. Then we make L-shaped trap, L-shaped flap. Here in the middle, we make L-shaped flap. You can see it. Then by the Kelly bands, you can make the trabeculectomy. Then after that, you make peripheral iridectomy. This is very important here. Full PRP is very important and a new vessel because the patient may bleed a lot. And a lot of cases will develop hyphema if you don't do proper band rate and photocoagulation. Then you close your flap by 10-0 monofilament nylon suture and make as you can suture long here. Because the long suture will help to do suture lysis later on if you need. Usually I close the flap tight because we have YAG laser machine. If you don't have YAG laser machine, so don't make it too tight because you are not able to do later on suture lysis. You want the filtration actually. Make it long as you can so you will be able to see the suture under conjunctiva by Hosken lens when you go for suture lysis. after the flap. Usually we test the flap here, but there is healing. You cannot make this test. We'll test later on when we close the conjunctiva. We close it with 9-0 Vicryl or 10-0 Vicryl. It is better to be round the needle, so you avoid the buttonhole and the leakage. Very tight closure of the flap is very important, especially the area close to the lambus. After closure, this is very important. After taking healing out, then we should form the bleb. This is very important step to form the bleb and check for leak. Here we close. Definitely, we should put suture because this is combined surgery. Better to put suture here to avoid infection for the bleb. Here we press on the side of the flap. You can see the AC, the bleb is formed now. Then you put one drop of fluorescein to test if there is leak. You can add more suture to the bleb. This is very important to test to do in all cases of trabeculectomy in the end of surgery. Then you wash the fluorescein. You remove the superior rectus suture and you inject the subconjunctival injection of steroid and antibiotic. This is the end of our surgery done for trabeculectomy for those cases. The criteria of success, complete success, defined intraocular pressure between 6 to 21 without medication, between 6 to 21. Above 21 with topical medication, they call it qualified success. يعني ممكن العملية تكون ناجحة ولكن على one medications والبريشر يكون controlled أقل من 21 دي بنعتبرها حاجة اسمها qualified success. تخش في السكسس. اما كومبليت فيلير لقيناه الحقيقه في ثلاث حالات which is intraocular pressure more than 21 in spite of medication والمريض غالبا بيحتاج ريسيرش. نيجي الريزلت عندنا الفولو اب افتر 37 months between 6 months to 94 months. البري اوب اي او بي بيكام 18، ذا مين از 18 which is statistically significant compared to بوست اوب تو بري اوب. And also medications, بوست اوب medication mean was 0.3 compared to 3 بري اوب. The blip is present in all successful cases till the last follow up and the complete success in 24 of 30. 24 مريض من ال 30 they have success which is 80% success rate. And this type of surgery, trabeculectomy in neovascular glaucoma. ثلاثة من المرضى they have qualified success. معناه إن البريشر became أقل من 21, less than 21 with medication, and overall success with 90%. The short-term complication, this is very important. Transient hypotony in 6 eyes, hyphema in 4 eyes, choroidal detachment in 2 eyes, shallow anterior chamber in 2 eyes, and one case have bleb leak. Long-term complications, cataract, we know that cataract is common after trabeculectomy in 2 cases only, but none of our cases in our study developed no light perception or hypotonous maculopathy or ptosis bulbar. So in conclusion, neovascular glaucoma is a preventable and a treatable condition. Anti-VGF have a central part in management as adjunctive therapy. It is temporary effect. It is not the main treatment of neovascular glaucoma. Pan-retinal photocoagulation is a definite treatment and the prerequisite for successful trabeculectomy in neovascular glaucoma. So in summary, this is a common secondary glaucoma with an open or closed angle. There is no pupillary block, so take care, never do BI in neovascular glaucoma. This is red flag. If you mention or you do BI in neovascular glaucoma, most common causes are diabetes, center retinal vein occlusion, and the carotid eye disease. The repeated gonioscopy is very important and mandatory even in absence of NVI in a patient at risk. And treating the underlying disease is a prerequisite for any successful surgical intervention. Thank you very much for all your kind attention. And I am ready to inquire and sharing your experience also about management of neovascular glaucoma. This is my email and also my telephone if you want to contact anytime. Dr. Islam.
Thank you, Dr. Assam, for this nice lecture. Really, it was nice and covers the subject nicely from A to Z, really. It is it was a wonderful presentation. First of all, I have a comment and then we will go to the questions. My comment, and I think we can share our experience together, that really in neovascular glaucoma, especially in diabetic patient, even if you did glaucoma surgery before for the patient, as Dr. Assam mentioned many times, gonioscopy is mandatory. Even sometimes if you have, especially you know, for diabetic patient, sometimes you cannot dilate the pupil well. And even if you cannot dilate the pupil, if you don't have a good fundus camera, especially if the new designs now, the 260, that you can even take pictures for fundus and narrow pupil, you will find that most of these cases, they were not having a good PRP. And so if you really just by a quick exam, just examine the angle, you will find, especially in early cases, you will find early neovascularization before the peripheral anterior synic. If you enlarge well your slit lamp, you can see the neovascularization in the angle. And the main treatment for these cases is just before you do your glaucoma surgery, just give the medical treatment, refer the patient to your retina specialist or retina consultant in your unit, and just complete the PRP first to give the IVGF, and then the PRP. After completing the PRP, most of these cases will be controlled even with one medication, and you can go further for the surgery. What do you think, Dr. Assam, about this?
I agree with you. This is the importance of awareness, as I mentioned before. You know, retina awareness of diabetes and diabetic retinopathy. مهمة جدا والاوارنس هو ده معناه ان انا I should bring all cases of diabetes, I should examine them, screening them, I should examine angle as you mentioned and treat the laser treatment early and important to be full PRP, not partial PRP.
Yes. We have many questions on the chat. I just will excuse or raise their hand just to answer the question in the chat first and then we will come to you later on. The first question was, what about using the anti-VGF in anterior chamber?
You can. I use it in some patients, actually.
Yes. Also, I use it, and it gives a good result. It augments the effect of your surgery, yes. Clear media, I think Dr. Amr replied and answered the question. Another question, why subiru nasal? You answer it, but can you repeat it again, Dr. Assam?
When you have a glaucoma surgery, whether it is non-penetrating glaucoma surgery or trabeculectomy or trab express, we usually start not in the middle of conjunctiva. We usually go subiru nasal. I'll show you the picture here. You can see the iridectomy is nasal. The surgery is subiru nasal. Why? Because if it is failed, you still have temporal part. You can go for another trab or you can go for tube. You still have another healthy conjunctiva. You can do the surgery.
Another question. What about using AHMA glaucoma valve? And what do you prefer, trab or valve?
This is actually good questions. Because I know some people, they like to put the tube as a primary procedure. I have no problem to put the tube as a primary procedure, but we prefer, and according to the study we did, that phakic patient, I like to go first by trabeculectomy with mitomycin. And if it is failed, I can go for tube. I like to start a tube in a patient with deep anterior chamber to avoid the problem and the complication of tube. You know already a phakic or pseudophakic patient, you have deep anterior chamber, so it is good a chance to have tube. And I also forget to tell you that the three cases failed in our study was pseudophakic. And when we do logistic analysis, we find that the risk factor of failure in our cases is pseudophakia. And that's why most of cases, for me, pseudophakic, I usually go for tube rather than trap.
Okay, another question from Dr. Taj asking about if your patient develop endophthalmitis a year after surgery, what is the cause? You are at the age of treatment, so what is the cause?
You examine the patient and you should tell me what is the cause. it may be erosion of the tube. Yeah, and majority of endophthalmitis actually usually come from erosed tube, erosion of the tube, or cystic bleb leak, late bleb leak.
Good reply, and let me add something. Especially, it is not an ad, just to share. What if you have a buttonhole over the tube? What is the best for covering this buttonhole?
Usually, I have a trend in doing my tube surgery. I usually put the tube under scleral flap. This is my way. I think also Prof. Tarek Shahrawi presents this. I usually do scleral flap above the tube. Then after that, I put also cornea and glycerin under the conjunctiva.
Yeah.
So if you have buttonhole, after all this, you can suture the buttonhole. But I told you, you can use round needle, not sharp needle. And you can suture this round buttonhole. But if you have erosion actually of the tube, instead of all this precaution, you can put pericardium or you can put whatever you have under conjunctiva, undermining, and suture the conjunctiva again.
Well, really, it is suturing the conjunctiva in a scarred conjunctiva will not help. Even sometimes if you put a patch graft from the conjunctiva, free patch graft, this sometimes even can erode later on. But I think if you, as you said, I think you bought a pericardium or patch graft again, or another thing that you can, especially if these cases were done by something, someone, not you, and you, he didn't do the scleral tunnel, I think doing another scleral tunnel will solve the problem.
Yes.
But just a conjunctival suturing, sometimes it is not efficient to close the buttonhole. Okay, and what is the parameters for the suture license by Hoskin lens laser?
Yeah, this is a very good question, actually. Some patients of neovascular glaucoma, they present with normal disc after BRB. And some patients are presented with damaged disc. He presented late. So you titrate the intraocular pressure after surgery with 10 to 21 for normal disc is okay for you. Don't make anything. This pressure is good. But if I have a 21 pressure and the patient has damaged disc, so I like to have lower pressure. So in this situation, I'm not happy about intraocular pressure, which is 21 because I have damaged disc. So I should go and making massage first. Before I do suture lysis, I should do massage first. Massage pressed by the any weak cell to the side of the flap until the bleb formed. If it is formed temporally, you make suture lysis temporally. If it is formed nasally, you make suture lysis nasally. And don't make these two suture lysis at the same time. Remove one suture first, then see the patient, if pressure is well controlled, it's enough. If it is not enough, you can go and make another suture lysis. So our parameters, if I'm not happy about the intraocular pressure.
Okay, Dr. Assam, we will take those who are raising their hand. With us now, Dr. Ahmad Abdul Ghani.
Fadal,
Dr. Ahmad.
Fadal.
Thank you, Dr. Assam Osman, for your talk very much. Neovascular glaucoma is still the nightmare scenario for glaucoma specialists, unfortunately. And I do agree with Dr. Islam about it needs a shared action between glaucoma specialists and retinal specialists, both of them in order to solve, to reach the optimal way for the treatment. Now, the question is about a study conducted by you about the full PRP improving the trabecular trabeculectomy outcome. Maybe I missed a point. Is this a comparative study? If you compare your study with something else, I mean...
No. PRP. It is just a cohort study. No, it is not comparative study.
It's so one directional and pilot one?
No?
It's not, it's like a pilot study? Yeah, I mean...
Yes.
All right, thank you very much.
Tislim.
دكتور ساري.
السلام عليكم.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله
وبركاته. For this very nice lecture really. My question about if there is any comparison about between the trabeculectomy and the tube surgery from the point of 5-year survival rate.
Yeah, you mean TVT study.
Yeah.
طبعا we know there is actually two studies about TVT, one old and one recent. And maybe the old one mentioned that on long run, the tube is better actually, on the old TVT study. But the recent study showed that maybe it is equal. The important here actually, when you talk about or you can make it in another way, I did tube or trap. Maybe this is what you want to know. When I do tube, when I do trap.
What's the best for the patient is?
طبعا the best according to the, as I mentioned before, if the patient is phakic, if the patient is phakic and have shallow anterior chamber.
Start to strap.
If the patient is phakic and the anterior chamber is not deep, better don't go for tube. You can go for trabeculectomy. If the patient is pseudophakic or aphakic, definitely the anterior chamber is deep, you can go for tube surgery. Even I like sometimes to put the tube in posterior chamber away from the cornea to avoid a loss of endothelium by time due to tube in anterior chamber. So the situation according to your patient himself and also according to your experience. If you are expert more in tube, you can tube from the start. If you are expert more in trap, you can do trap. And definitely also if you have patient with poor visual potential or no light perception. If poor visual potential, that means the patient is end stage glaucoma. There is no hope of visual improvement. And also there is disc damage. So no benefit of improvement. In this situation, actually, you can go for cyclophotocoagulation. So even micropulse or ordinary CBC is good in some patients. Don't go in dilemma of operating him by tube or trabeculectomy, and there is no visual potential. I hope this is the answer for you.
Thank you. Also, according when the patient, sometimes the patient are presented with very high intraocular pressure and very bad neovascularization of the iris. So in this scenario, we want to make all treatment, but the treatment, how we will start the treatment? We'll start then the anti-glaucoma first or the injection first?
This is good question. Actually, we have guideline in our university about treatment of neovascular glaucoma. The guideline, when the patient came to emergency, he should start the anti-glaucoma medication by the emergency team before consult even the glaucoma. They put the patient on Bradford, atropine, Combigan, and Diamox, and they call the retina first. So our protocol, they start the emergency team by the anti-glaucoma medication, steroid, and atropine. Then they call first the retina people. The retina people came and they finished PRP, or they arrange to finish the PRP. Most of patients, they came at night. The كنت شفت مرضى neovascular glaucoma, معظمهم بيجوا في الليل للأسف. فإحنا الجايد لاين to start the medications when they come to emergency, call the retina people. Retina people finish their job of PRP and laser treatment, or and sorry, Avastin injection. then the patient will come back to the glaucoma within 3 to 5 days for decision of type of surgery will do. طبعاً definitely seen by glaucoma also at that time.
Yeah, it's a teamwork.
It's a teamwork between, because I know some people are doing the same retina and glaucoma, فمaybe the patient will be in good hand.
دكتور لؤي okay. معنا؟
أيوة معك. السلام عليكم. Thank you first for the presentation. I have a question regarding the poor media. You mentioned if you have a patient with neovascular glaucoma and poor medium, that we suppose, for example, to do for him anti-VEGF, then after that you will do for him phaco, then the PRP laser. You don't feel that it's better to give a better chance for the success rate for the TRABI to do combined better phaco TRABI, then after that the PRP laser? Because if you will do phaco only, then after that you will do the, if you will need to do TRAB, you will need to wait time or your success rate for the TRAB will be less. I don't know, what's your opinion about that?
طبعا احنا sometimes it is يعني هي مش قرآن fixed, واخد بالك؟ ان انت sometimes you have flexibility. يعني sometimes you remove the cataract, we do endo laser at the same time, and sometimes actually we go for TRAB and the cataract and the endo laser at the same time by assistant of retina people with you. It depends upon the availability, what is available for you, حد معاك, you are alone, and what you are expert to do. And now we have no problem to share this combined procedure at the same time.
Okay.
Dr. Khalid Al-Husseini. Dr. Khalid.
Assalamu alaikum. I want to thank Dr. Assam for the topic and for the nice presentation. I have a few comments first, then I have a few questions for Dr. Islam and Dr. Assam. My first comment, I want to emphasize about the importance of examination of the pupil in diabetic patient. Yeah, we can catch the patient in the state of pupil iridis. So all the diabetic patients, you have to examine the pupil. And in neovascular glaucoma, you have to examine the other eye. One eye may be having neovascular glaucoma, and the other eye in the stage of pupillary iridis, so you can prevent further damage for the other eye. The other point I want to emphasize on the importance of PRP treatment for all proliferative diabetic retinopathy. There is a trend in the retina subspecialty for anti-VEGF treatment instead of the PRP. So it's very important. PRP is still very important, especially for our cohort of patients. The other point, sometimes inadequate PRP because the undilated, the poor dilatation of the patient of diabetes. So we don't want to forget, we have another armamentarium, another tool in treatment of this patient, maybe the peripheral cryo beside of anti-VEGF treatment. My questions to Dr. Islam, Dr. Assam, about the treatment in some patients, this diabetic patient, hypertensive with bad general condition. What about CVC and anti-VEGF treatment? What is the results of something like that? And I want to ask about combined cataract with trabeculectomy or combined cataract with the valve, especially if this patient has some sort of insignificant cataract. Thank you.
Islam, doctor.
Last thing I want to comment about. Sometimes you have the patient have high intraocular pressure, and you can't do. The PRP because of the high intraocular pressure. Sometimes I used to do paracentesis in order to lower the intraocular pressure a little bit to prevent the corneal edema arise with the placement of the lens on the cone. Thank you.
شكرا اولا على المعلومه الحلوه اللي انت قلتها اللي هي لازم الواحد يشوف البيوبل بطريقه صح. سليت لامب اكزامينيشن هاي ماجنيفيكيشن and we should look for the other eye. بالنسبة للكومنت الأولاني إن المريض هايبرتنسيف دايبيتك، إحنا ماجورتي أوف أور بيشنت دايبيتك هايبرتنسيف، يعني ما هيش حاجة غريبة usually they are critical patient, medical ill. انت تدي انتي في جي اف مع سي بي سي, there is no يعني what is indication. احنا اتفقنا مبدئيا ان انتي في جي اف is not the main treatment. تاني حاجة السي بي سي تعتمد البيشنت, في البيشنت احتاج تراب او تيوب, وبعدين البيشنت اللي يخش العمليات ويبقى fit for سي بي سي he will be fit for trap and tube. احنا طبعا المريض اللي بيخش سي بي سي بيخش الاو ار, ما بتعملش في الاوت بيشنت. It should be cleared by anesthesia. Whether he is sick, diabetic, hypertensive, وأحيانا يكونوا على warfarin ومشاكل كبيرة, يكونوا عندهم bleeding tendency ونومهم خمس أيام, ولازم يخش العمليات اللي بيكون INR أقل من 1.2. فthis is a lot of problems. إنما provided the patient دخل عمليات, so you should do the best treatment for him. He need trap or tube, or if he do, you can do CBC in certain situations. If you don't have actually you have poor media and retina people will delay the interference of vitrectomy and vitreous hemorrhage, you can do CBC until the retina people finish their problem. إنما طبعاً Avastin alone is not the treatment. السؤال الثاني إحنا اتكلمنا عليه الحقيقة يمكن جاوبناه في الدكتور اللي مر من قبل, كان بيتكلم على combined surgery. You can do combined surgery definitely, and even the video I presented was combined surgery. And the
هو حاجة يعني قصدي هل حتى لو عينه عنده insignificant cataract you would prefer to do for him combined phaco؟
لا أنا المريض لو insignificant cataract I will not touch the lens. I want to treat the problem now. I want to treat the problem. His vascular grow, I should do trap or tube or CBC. The cataract is simple thing is anyone can do cataract surgery for him later on. يعني don't concentrate. I know طبعا the era of phaco now everybody want to do the cataract surgery. Cataract if it is not significant, majority of people diabetic hypertensive above 50 years they have nuclear sclerosis. But if you have clear media to see the retina, please don't touch the lens and do your job. It is not necessary to go for cataract surgery except if it is affect your job in doing the laser treatment. بالنسبة للموضوع الثالث اللي اتكلمت فيه اللي هي هاي اي بي, طبعا كل البيشنت في نسكر الكلوكوما دي بريزنت ويز هاي اي بي, ما فيش مريض هيجي لك. المشكله ما هوش في الهاي اي بي, المشكله في الكورنيال اديما. اي ثينك ذيس از يور بوينت, يو ار نوت سينج. طبعا وي هاف ا لوت اوف اكسبيرينس وذ ريتينا بيبل. احنا طبعا الرول عندنا ان بنفضل المريض يتنوم في المستشفى, افضل اديله جليسرين اذا هو مش دايابيتك لو سنتر ريتينا فين اوكلوجن مثلا, او جليسرين حتى لو دايابيتك under control, او اديله مانيتول. And provide the patient inside the hospital, resident بيشوف البيشنت, when the cornea is clear, he go and finish the PRP. النقطة الثانية, some people, they remove even the epithelium and they do the van Ritten photocoagulation. النقطة الثالثة اللي ذكرتها وده كنا بنعملها زمان وما عرفش حد بيعملها دلوقتي ولا لأ, if there is corneal scar and definitely no, you cannot do PRP, some retina people, they still do peripheral cryo. Still doing actually with Avastin. طبعا this is good, and I don't think this patient they usually don't have good visual potential. I hope this is answer of your question. Thank you very much for your comment.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
معنا دكتور وليد طنطاوي وطالب دكتور ساري يكون معاه كمان.
السلام عليكم.
أهلا
وسهلا. عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
دكتور عصام شكرا جزيلا. I'm very unlucky I didn't attend from the beginning يعني because of the time zone difference, and I'm بتكلم in England so I got a bit mixed up with the timing. As you said at the end of your nice talk that treating the cause of neovascularization is paramount in treatment. In cases of retinal ischemia, so either vein occlusion or artery occlusion or diabetic retinopathy, injecting intravitreal anti-VEGF is effective short-term until you perform PRP, زي ما حضرتك تفضلت. But injecting anti-VEGF in the AC, I believe it will be washed out quickly in a few minutes. So I'd be interested to hear your comment on this and to hear the comment of the retina crew as well.
We are not advising to do it, but if you do it, it will not insult the patient. We are not advised to put anti-VGF in an anterior chamber. Even there is some studies talk about trabeculectomy with Avastin injection in the bleb to survive the bleb. But actually we are not advised to give anti-VGF, but if you don't, if you give it, you will not lose anything. Maybe you will not benefit, as you mentioned, it will be washed, but it will not, it is not our advice as a routine in our management. But intravitreal injection, we prefer to be given because this will help actually to enhance the success rate of our glaucoma surgery. Shukran, Dr. Shukran, Tisla.
Yeah, so as you said, Yani, it's not advised. And how Yani, in few minutes will be washed up quickly. So why do we give it then?
Yes.
I think it's preferable in non-penetrating, but in TRAP, it will be washed out before even you took the needle out.
Yeah, that's
but the non-penetrating, this is red flag. Dr. Islam Hassan, somebody will misunderstand. Non-penetrating is contraindicated in
neovascular glaucoma. Yeah, it is not for neovascular.
Yeah, but Hassan, had the fam khata, yeah.
The problem also in touching the AC in such cases, the hyphema, this can be complicated with hyphema and can complicate the case more. So even when we inject anti-VEGF in such cases, even if the pressure is high, I prefer to not to enter the AC and do paracentesis to lower the pressure after injection, because you are taking the risk of hyphema, and hyphema will complicate the case more. So it's better not to do paracentesis or injection in the AC at all.
Majority of people of retina, they do gradual decompression by paracentesis before the intravitreal injection, actually.
I prefer now to do it without paracentesis, because the hyphema can be horrible after
paracentesis. Definitely. He may get hyphema when you do paracentesis, definitely.
Yeah, and this also in the case of neovascular glaucoma, you can get shallow AC and iridocorneal corneal touch, and paracentesis in such case really is horrible and can complicate the case very much. So even if we inject, just we look to the desk and be sure that there is no there's pulsation and the central retinal artery is working, and that's all. Even if the pressure is high, it will resolve within 1-2 hours maximum. But if you have hyphema, it will be a very big problem. If you have shallow AC, if you have iridocorneal touch, all these complications are very, very difficult to manage.
بس الحقيقه دكتور سري انه يعني زي ما الدكتور عصام عرض في الحاله بتاعته هو if you are doing trabeculectomy anyway you might have paracentesis anyway.
Yeah, when you prepare the patient for trabeculectomy, I think the patient is quiet. Yani he took treatment, he becomes quiet. I am talking about the patient presenting for the first time with angry eye and the
paracentesis.
Yeah. This is the time of injection. But trabeculectomy, before you do the trabeculectomy, you can prepare the patient and you can lower the pressure by other means till the patient is ready for TRAP.
Thank you, doctor. Actually, there is contradiction between glaucoma and retina people in this point. And for me, I prefer not to do paracentesis in emergency for those patients. And that's why I told you the guideline we give the patient.
Yeah,
right. Acetazolamide, we give cycloplegic, we give full anti-glaucoma medication. Then the retina people came, the pressure is little. I am not tell the pressure is lower, but it is little. Then they can give the anti-VEGF. But some people, instead of this, some people, retina people, they like to do the
paracentesis. I saw patients lost their eye because of the paracentesis. This is because that's why I'm stressing on this.
It needs expert one who did this.
Yeah, they lose totally their eyes and they come
to eyes could be quiet. Yeah.
We have Dr. Khalid Hassan also.
Sorry. Can I just comment or?
Dr. Walid.
دكتور ساري يعني حضرتك الابروتش بتاعك ان انت بتقول ان هو to give treatment, medical treatment to lower the pressure. Then yeah. When the pressure is lower, to give the anti-VEGF intravitreal. Is yeah, that correct?
That's right.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Dr. Khalid.
Hey, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu
alaikum. فرصة طبعا ان انا اشكر دكتور عصام على النشاط
ده. دايما متاخر يا دكتور خالد، ليه كده؟
يا دكتور عصام والله انت عارف في الشغل هنا انا ما خدتش بالي خالص ان في اكتيفيتي اساسا، يعني حتى ما عرفتش امبارح.
حبيبي احنا منتظرينك لمحاضرتك المقبله ان شاء الله.
ان شاء الله. سؤالي ليك والدكتور وليد بالنسبه للنون فالف امبلانت، هل يعني تعتقد ان ممكن يديك سيرفايفل افضل من احمد امبلانت؟ معظمنا شغال على احمد ويعني ممكن ناخد نتيجه كويسه تو سام اكستنت. النون فالفد سواء كان بيربلد او الايرولاب ديفايس، هل تعتقد انه ممكن يديك يعني لونج تيرم سيرفايفل افضل؟
والله يا دكتور خالد احنا طبعا ما اشتغلناش اللي هو النون فالفد، انما الحقيقه اور كوليج ان كيكيش اشتغلوا، they found that the non-valved is better to put it in children. واحمد فالف افضل في الادلت يعني. انما على اللونج ران الاستاديز كلها مبينه ان نو ماركت ديفرنس يعني على اللونج ران، انما في التشيلدرن بيفضل انك تحط البيرفلد اكوردنج تو زير اكسبيرينس نوت ماي اكسبيرينس. احمد فالف طبعا في نقطه مهمه جدا يمكن بعض الناس متفق معايا فيها، ان I should start one anti-glaucoma medication one week after putting Ahmed Valve for all patients. Because this will prevent and stop the encapsulation.
The hypertensive.
Yes.
يعني
yes.
glaucoma medications بتستعمل حسب الحالة، يعني أوقات كتيرة بتبقى يعني phase في الهيلينج وبعد كده ممكن تسحب الجلوكوما.
لا، وانت حسب، انت لو حطيتها حسب الحالة you lose a lot of patients. أنا الحين بحطها روتين ليا. Any patient with Ahmed Valve after one week I start one medication. If he has disc damage I usually put Alfagan. If the disc is good I put him on Timolol or other medications. وبعد كده بعمل له assessment. Suppose the pressure is well controlled later or I can stop this medication. ولكن to prevent hypertensive phase. يعني أنا وجدت في study عاملينها لأحمد Valve. إن شاء الله it is accepted and it will be published near يعني. This shows that the qualified success, the complete success is 38%. In 112 patient and the qualified success is 80+% and those qualified success was the patient who started anti-glaucoma medication early. If I advise when you use Ahmed Valve to start medications 1 week after surgery, at least one medication to prevent this hypertensive phase and encapsulation.
تمام.
Dr. Islam
شكرا.
Can give us
No, I am not a big fan of the valves, but anyway, for the post-op, really, it depends on the IOP. Neuroprotection, you can add it even from the beginning, because mostly of these cases is in the stage. The other thing that, especially in neovascular glaucoma, you have to be aware about the effect of VRP on your OCT and visual field. Because sometimes you can get even a tubular vision, and this is mostly from the effect of BRP on the retina. So you have to do the 10 dash of the macula, which is most preferable in these cases. What do you think, Dr. Assam and Dr. Khalid? Dr. Walid?
دكتور اسلام.
Yes, did you hear me?
You hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
اللي اتقطع شوية الصوت.
طيب, did you hear what I said? دكتور عصام خرج من الشكل النت عنده قطع. دكتور خالد, did you hear what I said?
طبعا ال most of the patients the visual prognosis تاعهم بيبقى limited, واوقات كتير بيبقى الفيجن من قبل ما تبدا يعني هتعتمد بشكل اساسي على التيوبولر, وبيبقى يعني very precise في الفولو اب مانجمنت. يعني انت لما بتعمل الفيجوال فيلد وتاسس اوفر تايم بتقدر تاشور البيشنت, لان المشكله في البيشنتس دول ان هو اوقات كتير بيبقى متوقع ان في جزء هيرجع له من اللوست, بس للاسف طبعا يعني اوقات كتيره الليميتد او التيوبولار فيجن بيخلي الاكتيفيتي بتاعته ليميتد شويه, فانت الاستابيليتي بتاعه الفيجوال فيلد ده البيست سكسس اللي احنا بنقدر ناتشيف. وفعلا يو كان مينتين ات.
طيب دكتور عصام دخل معانا تاني, معلش هو كان النت قطع من عنده تقريبا.
يعني
سامعك دكتور عصام, اتفضل.
خالد على الكومنتس اللي قاله الحقيقه, وان كان طبعا احنا معروف ان الافكت بي ار بي والافكت ذا فيجوال فيلد وذا بيشنت, يعني تاني نقطة مهمة برضو عايز أعلق عليها على كلامك، إن majority of those patients of neovascular glaucoma if they presented early, treated in good way, they preserve the vision الحقيقة. يعني I forget one slide to show you the visual acuity post our study. It was good. It was not bad. Many patients improve up to 20, 30 even vision. Because this is secondary glaucoma, if you save the eye and the disc is saved, the patient usually have good visual acuity. But unfortunately, majority of patients of neovascular presented sometimes they are late. This is the problem.
We have many questions on the chat. First of them, before we conclude, what about the sutures and the effect of astigmatism on TREP? They are still asking about the, if you are taking your IOL calculation, did the suturing of the TREP will affect the end result of your IOL?
On long run, it will not affect.
Yes.
On long run, it will not affect.
The temporary astigmatic effect.
Yes.
Okay. Another question about using the CBC on sub-threshold or the micro-pulse CBC.
It is the same, Dr. Islam. Whatever you have, you can do. If you have micro-pulse CBC, I prefer because less inflammation. But our ordinary CBC is the same. This is the same idea.
But micro-pulse CBC in advanced cases, the company said that this is not effective and it's not beneficial. It will lower the pressure, but you will not get rid of the medication.
In neovascular, in any case, you did cyclophotocoagulation, you cannot get off medication.
No, the micro-pulse. I mean the micro-pulse. Sorry for the internet problem with Dr. Assam.
You hear me now?
Yes, فضل دكتور اسلام.
تفضل يا دكتور اسلام.
النت عندك بيقطع معلش. طيب في question تاني عن ال immediate medical treatment after NER for neovascular glaucoma and what is the role of cortisone eye drops? Did you hear?
The
immediate treatment after an ER for
question, please.
Immediate treatment in ER for neovascular glaucoma and post-op, and the role of cortisone, of corticosteroids. Neovascular glaucoma.
Repeat again fast.
The ER medication for
neovascular glaucoma. I mentioned ER medication. You should start with acetazolamide.
Yes.
Diamox, you can give it, better to be regular Diamox, QID, 250 milligram, and you can give medications, topical medication like Timolol and Alphagan, plus Atropine and Bradford. You can hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, yes.
This is a medication at emergency.
Okay. I think this we answer most of the question, and there is one question, last question. What about lower IOB in case of neovascular glaucoma? How do you deal with it?
Now we mentioned before that if you have low IOP or normal intraocular pressure and there is definite diagnosis of neovascular glaucoma, you should refer a patient to a medical doctor because he may have carotid artery disease. The main treatment is endarterectomy, but usually the pressure will be raised after endarterectomy and you can take the patient back for TRAB or tube.
Okay. Again, the same question, what is the role of corticosteroid eye drops in neovascular glaucoma?
It decreases the inflammation. It is very important to put the patient on frequent steroid because this decreases inflammation. Usually the pain from inflammation rather than high intraocular pressure.
Okay. So I think we answer most of the questions. If anyone have any questions, you can just chat or raise your hand because we will conclude now. Okay. I think Dr. Lai is raising his hand at the last one.
Again.
Dr. Lai, please.
Yes, I have just a small comment regarding what Dr. Walid Tantawi and Dr. Sari were talking about, which is the paracentesis. So our consultant, he used to, if you want to skip the paracentesis and the pressure is high, he used to aspirate a few drops from the core vitreous, then inject the anti-VGF. This way you can skip the paracentesis. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Lai.
Shukran, when can sot mish wadah Islam, I think he...
السلام استاذ حضرتك وافقني لو فيني اليوم دكتور احمد جمعه الدكتور ثري لو حضرتك نسمع اسئلتهم ولو الدكتور عصام رجع نقدر نسمع اجابته
نعم
في الدكتور احمد جمعه والدكتور ثري رافعين ايديهم فممكن نسمع أوكي. اسئلتهم لغايه ما الدكتور عصام الصوت يرجع
دكتور احمد اتفضل
السلام عليكم
وعليكم السلام ورحمه الله وبركاته
What is your opinion to put atropine drop at time of trabeculectomy surgery to prevent malignant glaucoma
سلام At time of what?
Of surgery at the same time of trabeculectomy.
Putting atropine drops at the time of surgery to prevent malignant glaucoma.
Doctor, atropine should be given any trabeculectomy for neovascular or not neovascular. We keep the patient. Atropine is a wizard for neovascular glaucoma or any type of glaucoma.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, شكراً.
بس كان دكتور لؤي بيسأل بيتكلم على إن الباراسنتيسيس instead of doing باراسنتيسيس they are doing vitreous stabbing and then injecting the anti-VGF before doing the باراسنتيسيس.
This is good idea, دكتور إسلام.
دكتور عمرو you can unmute yourself دكتور عمرو تفضل دكتور عمرو دكتور عمرو محفوظ جلوكوما كونسلتنس المدينه دكتور عمرو you have the mic دكتور عمرو
طب ناخد دكتور ساري بعدين نرجع للدكتور عمرو
دكتور ساري تفضل
هي البوينت بتاع الدكتور لؤي حكايه ان احنا نسحب جزء من الفيتريس اتس فيري جود بوينت بات ذا بروبلم از ات از نوت وركينج ميني تايمز بيكوز ذا نيدل يو انجكت ويز اور ذا نيدل يو وونت تو ويذدرو ذا فيتريس از فيري ثيك ذات يو كانوت اكستراكت اني فيتريس سو اتس ا جود بوينت بات اف ات اف ات از وركينج وي ار دوينج ات روتينلي اف وي انجكت ان سوتش بيشنتس But many times it's not working and you cannot withdraw the vitreous with this needle. So also if you, I want to stress again on the paracentesis, it's better to avoid.
Dr. Islam, في بس سؤال على الشات من الدكتور ريف
شبع. Dr. Ois is asking about pseudophakic eyes, combined surgery. So you are already dealing with a pseudophakic eye, ACD. The question, why you didn't use it tube, means a tube? use the tube instead of trap.
احنا قلنا ان بنعمل تيوب في السودوفيكت الاسلام. We mentioned that tube is recommended in
السودوفيكت. Yeah, but he has said that it is already a السودوفيكت, especially in your case. You already did it is a السودوفيكت. To combine means to combine the tube, if I understand the right, to combine the tube with FECO.
You can.
Yeah. Okay, Dr. Amr, again, I don't know why he didn't. Okay, Dr. Amr, you can unmute yourself.
Yes, guest. No, he's a co-host. Of large cystic polyp, Dr. Mohammed Al-Sayed. Let me see Amr.
Large cystic polyp, Dr. Assam.
ايه المشكلة؟
Nothing.
Treatment. حد بيسأل على التريتمنت يعني.
It's nothing.
يعني just هو follow up. هو في موضوعنا. و large cystic polyp problem.
دكتور عمرو ما عادش موجود على الشات خالص.
اي عمرو, دكتور عمرو شكله في عنده مشكله في النت فمش موجود على الميتين.
لارج والاوفر فلتريشن بليب دي موضوع يعني كبير نتكلم فيه في انذر ليكشر يعني
ان شاء الله
باذن okay. الله.
طيب I think we have reached our last question now. احنا thanks دكتور عصام, بنشكر دكتور عصام جدا على المحاضره الرائعه وربنا يكرمك وينفع بيك دايما ويجزاك كل خير. وبنفكر بمحاضرتنا القادمه ان شاء الله بكره مع دكتور عبد الله المنيسي, وان اوف ذا ايمننت نيورو اوفثالمولوجي كونسلتنتس ان اول سعودي عربيا اند ايفن ان ذا ميدل ايست. هي ويل توك اباوت اوبتيك ديسك سويلنج ا كلينيكال ابروتش. اور تايم ان تومورو ويل بي ات 7. ذا اذر ثينج ذات وي هاف اول اور فيديوز اون ذا يوتيوب شانل and on the Telegram, it is called Online OFSA. If you search on Online OFSA, we already put the link many times. You will put it again now. This is the link for the YouTube channel and the Telegram channel. Just search by Online OFSA. You will find this lecture for Dr. Assam and all the lecture for the previous lectures and all the coming lectures, inshallah. Thank you again and شكرا دكتور عصام مرة تانية.
شكرا دكتور اسلام, شكرا for all, thank you.
Okay. شكرا جزيلا. نلقاكم على خير ان شاء الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله.